This is not a picture of a foot. Okay, yeah, it is a picture of a foot, but I can Google it and text it and tweet it. I didn't tweet it. See, this is the Egyptian hieroglyphic for foot. You've probably seen videos with weird characters like this or Tom Scott's experiments with them. But what's going on here? These aren't just emojis, it's deeper than that. They're part of a standard that governs almost all of the internet with characters like this, and this, and this. And it's even been the source of international controversy. How did it happen? Now we're starting our screen grab here. This is just one of the most inexplicably fun things to do. Playing cards. So you can search for a playing card with a playing card. That is so cool. Now, as I mentioned, there are already videos that touch on the mysteries involved behind all these different letters, but they're usually kind of tech-oriented, and there's no basic explanation of the history that is involved. So this video is not gonna be this.
The Unicode standard has a common code data repository.
But it also won't be this. Where do emojis come from? And why is fire so fire? And what about this little stinker? Whoa! It's gonna land somewhere in the middle. All of these symbols are typable because of Unicode. Let's just walk through in a straightforward way what's going on here. Imagine an uppercase A. So that is this, and this, and this, and this, but those are all different fonts. They have to map to some universal A instruction. That's what Unicode does. It says, I'm gonna give you a number for A. And every computer and font and operating system is gonna use that same number. It is a standard. So let's do the vocab. That number is called a code point, and the font turns it into a glyph. So because they have different meanings, A and A and A and A and A and A all get their own code point. Font designers can then choose how many of these code points that they want to draw letters for. Google's Noto is one of the most famous font families because they drew out a ton of Unicode characters for it. But that still doesn't explain this. I mean, Egyptian hieroglyphics? To understand why those would be part of Unicode, you have to learn a little bit about its history. Okay, so this ruggedly handsome actor is portraying Ronald.
Computers are going to help us beat those dirty communists.
But he has a problem. Across the country, there's Don.
Hi, Ron. Don. Ron. Don.
But Don is using a different standard. Remember, there's no Unicode yet. So when Don sends Ron a letter about a duck, the number that he assigns to D might be the number that Ron assigns to the letter F.
I have never seen this word before, and I don't like the way it makes me feel.
So everyone agrees that you have to create a standard, the most famous of which is the ASCII standard, which you might be familiar with from ASCII art. Okay, stop that immediately. Here is the first 1963 document that established ASCII. And here's the table that set the rules. You can see the uppercase A right here. Later, they filled those unassigned areas with lowercase letters. Here's the 1972 version of ASCII with a lot of wrinkles ironed out. There's our capital A, but a lowercase a too. But that wasn't enough. ASCII only had room for 128 characters. Look at that again. Try writing Russian with that.
Did you say Russian, you dirty communist son of a-
Or even languages with accents. I mean, how did A work? So everybody started creating their own standards or tacking onto ASCII. Bill had one, Steve had one. This was a huge mess. There were a ton of different versions now for every single country. This is all the background for a proposal that we call Unicode 88.
Excuse me, am I done here?
You're good.
Okay.
Unicode 88 showed up in this landscape of chaos and rivalry. One of the co-authors, Joe Becker, had been thinking about multilingual word processing for a while, but with different ideas. Unicode 88 cemented a plan to expand ASCII's abilities to reliable, real-world text encoding. The paper actually organized languages by gross national product to show which ones they should tackle first. And most importantly, it brought up the number of code point possibilities to more than 65,000. Wow, right? It was even backward compatible with ASCII through some clever organizing that made the first 128 Unicode code points the same as ASCII's numbers. It also plainly stated, is it possible to engineer a reasonable definition of character such that all the world's scripts contain fewer than 65,536 of them? The answer to this is yes. The Unicode Consortium was created in 1991, and every engineer, they suddenly became a cool 90s grunge guy.
I've got opinions about Pearl Jam.
I found this 1995 article where lots of commentators recognized that Unicode may hold the most promise for making the internet multilingual. But what about the foot? I mean, why'd they add stuff like hieroglyphics in? And why would YouTube end up supporting it? Well, almost immediately, Unicode realized that they had made the same mistake as ASCII. Still too few characters. So there are thousands upon thousands of Japanese and Korean and Chinese characters. They often refer to the same words or ideas, and they have differences that seem minimal to Westerners or people like me who don't know how to read them. Unicode decided they could save a ton of space if they consolidated all these Han characters under the same numbers. Proudly saying they'd avoided making tens of thousands of code points. Some people in Japan, China, and Korea did not think that this was so elegant of a solution. Imagine our A. It's like Unicode said A and A are the same thing. It's like sort of fine, but also totally wrong. That is what they did with the Han characters. They said characters that looked different, but had the same definition, meant the same thing. Now listen, I'm not gonna pretend that I learned how to read all these characters for this video. All these different images were transformed to one code point. People could choose a different type of font that might properly render the difference between the characters, but that's not how it was supposed to be done in Unicode. Unicode was supposed to have one code point for every single idea of a letter. This controversy, it became known as Han unification. People from each of these countries protested that doing that erased important etymological and historical differences between the ways that each country wrote the characters. After this debate, I would argue that Unicode suddenly kind of became sensitive to the idea, to non-English needs for their standard. In addition, they must have known that a newer and bigger and more comprehensive standard would have threatened theirs. And finally, rising computer capabilities kind of meant that there wasn't a reason not to include more and more characters. So they made tech upgrades and they started adding code point after code point after code point. This chart, adapted from John Cook, shows the growth in Unicode characters. And that's where we are today. I mean, today Unicode adds many ancient and very obscure languages, and in 2010, they also took control over the code points for emojis. Just like letters, there's a code point and a glyph for, you know, spaghetti, which is why different apps render it differently. Unicode ballooned to 149,186 characters. So that's the answer to our question. The hieroglyphic foot is a part of Unicode, and a bunch of different companies say, we want to support every possible language, so they support Unicode, and the foot comes along for the ride. This chart, adapted from Google's index of web pages, shows how Unicode soared up as ASCII use fell. The Unicode standard surpassed ASCII in around 2007 or 2008, and it has only grown since. There are other controversies over characters that I didn't get into, but you can imagine what they might be. But I'm gonna leave you with the positive. I mean, this is a really hard problem at the scale of human expression, yet we've kind of done a good job with it. We have found a solution. And the truth is that sometimes a solution, it looks like a foot. Okay, that's it for this one. Thank you for watching. Yeah, I love looking at all the different Unicode characters. I didn't get into a bunch of the technical details, but those are out there on YouTube if you want to learn more about how it works. There's planes and UTF-8 and UTF-16 and there's a lot, okay? And you can find that. That's what YouTube is good for. But I wanted to provide a general history. So hopefully this gives you an idea of how we got an internet and computers and operating systems that work across a bunch of different languages. If you haven't been here before, this is a personal channel. It's where I post personal videos, history videos, stuff like that. I've got a reaction video to this one over on Patreon. I like to go into all the stuff that I left out of the video proper, just because it would have been too long, and I kind of give you the details there. So yeah, maybe you'll join me over there. If not, I hope to see you in the next video regardless. All right, thanks for watching, and happy typing. Ooh, this comments section is a challenge to have some very interesting Unicode characters in it. So I am sure you will meet the challenge. All right, bye.